We'll get started. Thanks everyone for coming. And this is part of our HDNR seminar series, and I wanted to mention that we do have one more talk in the series, which will be May 5th, which Nia Morales will be coming to speak about diversity and conservation. So great pleasure to introduce Scott Jones today, who's actually been here all week and part of next week working with the CLTL program as well. So we greatly appreciate you coming and contributing to that and also to the seminar series. So Scott has an incredibly diverse background, which is just amazing. I learned new things just now about your background. So he's a restoration ecologist and anthropologist who works around the world, and we'll see examples of that now, on natural resources and on conflict management as well. But Scott's background includes work as a mental health and general nurse, and he's a trained Air Force pilot as well. So get busy, all of you. His main focus is on ecological restoration of degraded African mountain forests and on facilitating complex multi-stakeholder processes and increasing the involvement of women and young people in conflict management. And he's the co-director of the Mind the Gap, which we'll hear about, Mind the Gap research and training. And he started that following an academic career in the US, the UK, and Eritrea as well. So join me in welcoming Scott Jones.
Thanks a lot, guys. If I speak like this, can you hear me at the back? Everything all right? I always say if I get over-enthusiastic or time gets short, my speed of speech increases, and I've got a funny accent coming from Britain anyway, so if you don't get it, then give me a shout, and I'll try and slow down. Good. We're starting off with, thank you very much indeed for having me here. I really appreciate the chance to give a talk about this, and thanks for the opportunity to be at CLTL as well. Really, really appreciate that. We've got a little story here from the 1990s up to this year, looking at ecological restoration in one part of East Africa. We're talking about African mountain woodlands with Eritrea and northern Ethiopia as the main focus. But really we're talking about the same ecosystem right down East Africa, and more will become clear. I didn't know in the mid-1980s when I first went to this place, during their war, the Eritrean independence war with Ethiopia, that I'd be standing a few years later, a couple of decades later, talking about the possible success of mountain restoration in East Africa. I still don't know that I can do that, but I'm a lot more optimistic today than I was then, and I'll give you a little bit of a few of those reasons why. The talk is based on a paper that's here, if you would like it. It's also electronic, if you'd like it, at that publication site there. There's quite a few slides. I'm going to tell it like a story. There's some numbers at the very end, or words at the very end, but there's not a lot of words in between. So it's mostly pictures. This was taken in 1984 when I stayed first in the Eritrean highlands with the Eritrean People's Liberation Front, who were very much into self-reliance. I learned later that this was a piece of olive wood, and that will become significant soon as well. This is food relief, which is still going into East Africa decades on because there's a drought, and these are AK-47s, which are still going into East Africa because there's not a drought. There's other things going on for that. So let's have a look at what we're talking about. We're talking today about African mountain woodlands, or the Afro-montane woodlands of East Africa. If you look on the right-hand side of the slide there, we're up in the north there, far north on the Red Sea in Eritrea. Same ecosystem across the border, across the water in the Gulf areas, and down through Ethiopia, an archipelago of the same mountain type down through East Africa, Kenya, Tanzania, on into Malawi, Zimbabwe, though there's only one tree left, one single juniper, a very famous juniper, down as far south as the Orange River in South Africa. This is an archipelago of Afro-montane woodlands. The species type we're talking about are olive and juniper, a little bit like the high deserts of eastern Oregon and California, Washington State, in ecosystem terms. So just to go on through this, we'll meet these people a bit later. We'll meet this person in particular a little bit later. This is what I saw in 1984, about a mile behind just the Ethiopian front lines, a heavily degraded juniper olive forest on its way to even more degradation. I learned later that this was a closed canopy forest in the 1910s, 1920s, with two harvests per year because of orographic cloud coming over the mountaintops. This is a 2,600 meter plateau. All that's left here is Dodonea Viscosa and Tassas in the local language, and almost nothing else. You can see one or two little buildings just here and here, the Hudmo of the local people. I thought this was due to deforestation during the Italian colonial period. Eritrea was an Italian colony. We found the remains of a sawmill. Overgrazing might be another cause of deforestation. The dry season cutting of olive for animal fodder, very nutritious leaves, so cut and carry. And you can see the skeletal remains of the forest at the back. Nature brings its own difficulties, locust infestations every 5, 6, 7 years. Just eat everything. So if you get a little olive seedling like this, it will go along with all the crops. There was also a war. This is the Eritrean trenches facing the Ethiopian front lines in the 1980s. That war is now over, but a proxy war is still going on. There's still a border dispute between the two countries. And this is the end point, really, I thought that I was documenting back at that time, with surface soils depleting, very high rates of erosion, lots of soil pedestals, A's and B horizons almost completely gone, lots of gully erosion, lots of backwash. You're getting the sense of a really heavily degraded system here. Buried soils revealed the previous surface of the soil. This was very rich in organic matter, but the surface erosion was just washing over over all the valleys. And this was the best that I saw, the most northerly remnant of Afro-montane juniper olive woodlands in Africa. Agriculture there, although they're a Muslim community, very unusual. And this was about the worst. So that I thought that this was going to be like that a few years later. Little islands of biodiversity in cemeteries. Quite a few people are writing about that now, if you're interested in island biodiversity and the role of cemeteries in ecological conservation. The soil's under here, very rich, very interesting. And it was this, little poicephalus parrots flying into this, that led me to understand how we might be able to germinate olive seedlings, because the next steps were restoration. So looking down here, this is a distribution of olive juniper woodlands, a tiny fragment up there in northern Somalia, which I almost got to see last year when I was working in some of the conflict areas of northern Somalia. And on a satellite image, you can see, roughly speaking, how the land is distributed. On the far right, you can see the Red Sea, a few clouds on the Red Sea coast, extremely hot, rising to a very high plateau here. Press two buttons at once. Very high plateau in the middle, and lowlands to the west. So quite similar in reverse to the Rockies here. You get very similar rain shadows and ecological effects, lots of altitudinal gradients that you guys would recognize here. We know that the trees were there a long time ago. This is a map from 1720, written up by the Portuguese Jesuits who looked at this area. And we have here Les Forêts et Montagnes, forests and mountains of northern Eritrea, as it became. We did some research, we did some transects, we did a look at some of this. We tried doing cuttings because it was impossible to regrow these plants from seed. They just weren't happening. And the Eritrean People's Liberation Front, with whom I was working, had tried, and they were getting like 0.5% to 1% success rate. It was extremely difficult to germinate them. So in Southern California, where they grow lots of olives, I worked with some folks there who showed me how to do cuttings. We got all that up there, planted several thousand trees, and along came the locusts 2 years later and ate my entire experiment. So that was 2 years into my PhD, and every piece of data that I collected was eaten by locusts, so I was not very happy. We repeated the experiments in Scotland. Very nice to have a courageous PhD supervisor who said that the lowlands of Scotland was roughly equivalent to the highlands of Eritrea. We did a bunch of experiments in greenhouses. They were very sweet. They gave me a huge set of greenhouses. We had about 60,000 seedlings growing at one point. And we did all the things that you might expect to do in a germination trial in the early parts of that, and planted lots and lots of seeds and grew lots of plants. We looked at root shoot ratios. We did all the things that you might expect of an autoecologist to do, looking at the individual species and also looking at their behavior as two species together. Very interesting times. This is a much younger looking me with the sort of few changes in the beard here. But these are 2.5-year-old junipers, so we forced the plants to see what the best is that we could do in the best conditions so we get some sense of what the plants might be like. And this is a 15-month-old olive. And this is a 15-month-old Megan Jones, if anybody's particularly interested in that, Things move on, don't they? We looked also at the, so we had a look at the supply side. What might we be able to do to increase the supply given the terrifically difficult field conditions, war, drought, very, very tough soil conditions, lack of water, very, very hard indeed to look at the demand side in any meaningful way, the supply side in any meaningful way to increase the numbers of seedlings that we could outplant. So we looked at the demand side when the war conveniently ended and we were able to get to Addis Ababa and Asmara. This is in Asmara, and you can see that the demands made by the cities on the countryside is sometimes a wee bit unsustainable. And we looked at the agriculture, the changing agricultural patterns, much more applicable in Tanzania, Kenya, Ethiopia, where land is being converted to agriculture. These woodland types are being converted to agriculture much more, but nevertheless, people's need for food obviously causes encroachment onto forests. We looked at other islands of biodiversity, religious places, where this is a juniper olive woodland in a sea of agriculture. The church has been fantastic in our work. The mosques have been fantastic in this. And we took a helicopter ride, thank you, Minister of Defense, after the war, to see what this looked like from above before there was much. We tried using Landsat and TM data to look at vegetation change detection. Very hard to get the algorithms right when the verticals, it's, you know, the really, really steep mountains. So we struggled a lot to use meaningful satellite data to try to do some calculations with that. We also took some measurements. This is the river Anseba down here, and we measured whatever we could to really try to deeply understand what was going on in what was the last remnant of this forest. Stage one done in 1991, PhD obtained, and a lot of sadness and a lot of joy. Sadness really because I thought we were looking at this gone, I thought we were charting the end of it. The government, because I went back out there, I wrote 113 proposals for research, and the 113th finally was awarded by the Norwegians, and I'll show you the guy that was responsible for that in a minute. So be patient if you don't get your first grant. I've kept them, they're in a box, 112, the cover sheets from 112 bids. Anyway, the Norwegians then funded the work. I went off to live in the village, learned Tigrinya, the local language, and sat in the village for 6 months, just going to weddings, going to funerals, talking about what we needed to do. They wouldn't allow me back up into the research area, which is a bit of a shame, but we were able to work closer to the capital city, about an hour's drive away from the capital. One day after 6 months, they called me into a meeting. I thought it was with the village elders. What they said was, no, you have to address the whole village and tell us what you want to do. So that was in Tigrinya. I stood up, thankfully, I was able to speak by that time and spoke to the women and the men and explained it. They thanked me, dismissed me, and then he talked about it for a couple of days and they said, okay, you can do this. We will release the land that I explained to the whole village. We'll probably tie their land up for 20 years. And they wanted fences, the Ministry of Agriculture wanted fences, and the biggest debate was, no, if you want this, if we want this together, it has to be no fences. You know, you guys have got to want it enough that you keep it for 20 years. Lots and lots of discussions with children, with herders, really a good amount of preparation for this. We then went in, we were given 6 nurseries across the country to experiment with genotypes and different plants. We planted 250,000 seedlings. In 6 nurseries. They donated half of each nursery over to this experiment. Very serious. Everybody's interested in native tree species. We looked at the olive and the juniper, which was native. They got to select these. You know, it was their deal. I wasn't just saying, we have to do this. They were what they wanted very much to work with olive and juniper. Lots of uses for those plants. And they also wanted a eucalyptus. So we chose Eucalyptus cladocalyx, because that was relatively easily available. And there was a suggestion that cladocalyx was not as allelopathic as some of the other eucalyptus about which a lot has been written. And we wanted to integrate the idea that of an experiment to see just how allelopathic and influential eucalyptus was. We did 8 experiments off of these things. The one that I mostly want to talk about, though 2 or 3 are described here, is this one, where we planted 10 by 10 rows of olive, juniper, and eucalyptus on their own. Juniper plus olive, eucalyptus plus olive, juniper plus eucalyptus on their own, and all three species together like this, eliminating the border plants that touched on each side so that we had a statistical roughly 64, maybe a few more in between, at 2 to 3 meter spacing where we could manage it, but the hills go up and down, there's rocks and things, but by and large, 2 to 3 meter spacing. This there was replicated 3 times in each of 3 villages in a randomized block design, so we had quite a few thousand trees out on the ground, and that was planted, as you'll see, fairly shortly. Before we planted, we worked with local people on developing really good stock in the nursery, in terms of how local people would see good stock as well. We worked very closely with a nursery manager who'd been around loads and loads of years. He's passed away now, but his name was Shaker Asmaram. Lots of fun, lots of good laughs, but he was a village elder who was a gatekeeper in lots of ways, so we really got on side with him. The government really wanted us to just kind of give a training program to people, but they agreed in the end to let us work in the village and see how we got on. And by the end of it, if there were any gaps, government extension workers could come in and add to what the villagers had already achieved. So we didn't really have a very top-down kind of ministry-led process. We had a much more village-led process, which fitted with the Liberation Front's culture, which is very much about self-reliance and grassroots up. This is the gentleman who I'm still in touch with. He's in Somalia right now. His name is Svein Olaf Olsen. Absolutely wonderful guy, just about to retire. But without him, we couldn't have done any of this. And he's still a very, very dear friend, working in extremely tough situations in East Africa, as he has been doing for 30 years. Fluent in Kiswahili, fluent in Norwegian and English, lovely guy. And when he came out to supervise the project, straight into the Land Rover and working with plants. This is Shaker Asmaram, this gentleman here. We agreed how boundaried this thing would be. This is the sort of land we're working on. This village, this land is on the edge of the village, one of 3 villages that agreed their land. And we painted it with sort of emulsion of some sort to indicate the boundaries. And lots of work saying to the villagers, this is what is coming along. We worked very hard to make sure the women as well as men were involved in extension work. We tried to work with young people as well as women and got people practicing digging holes so that we could talk about water going in and depth of soil, and people could actually feel the soil in a slightly different way and anticipate what it might be like for an olive or a juniper living in that soil for 20, 30 years before they started planting them. So lots of interest in soil and rocks and dirt and music and just getting things going in a holistic kind of a way before we started digging. This is probably the best soil we ever had. We put a lot of effort into nursery management, a lot of effort into preparation of the holes into which the seedlings would go. So a lot of upfront costs, if you like, probably about 80 or 90 cents per American cents per tree in today's money. Quite expensive. We agreed that there would be 1 watering at the time of planting and 1 weeding, and that's it. That anything that died after that died. Anything that lived, lived. So we wanted to get most of it right in the nursery and most of it right in the planting. Up early in the morning with a Land Rover that the Norwegians kindly gave us, planting, lots of fun, lots of laughter, making sure the roots were nicely protected, and we paid people. We paid people at a time when money wasn't easy to find, and we made sure we had half women, half men, and that it was all done courteously, kindly, well audited, and that everybody knew exactly what was going on. Everything was nicely public, and we had little parties and things. We had celebrations for thanking people, even though they were paid, to make sure that they were given little certificates for how many holes they dug and things, and just made it a kind of village thing. It was a lot of fun, but it wasn't patronizing. We made sure that this all fitted with what people would like, and it was the end of the war, so we had a bit of an advantage because people were feeling kind of good anyway. Another experiment I just touched with, we did agroforestry things to see if we could grow barley in between the olives. And then we left it, and I didn't realize I'd be gone for 20 years, but I was. And then I was in Norway and said, well, you know, this thing's been going for 20 years, I wonder how it's doing. Shall we go back and have a look? We'd sort of been in touch. A couple of people had been out, taken a few photographs. We thought, yeah, a few may have survived, and what exactly? So the Norwegians, very kindly, same guy, Svein Olsen, applied to the Norwegian Development Agency and got some money, and this is what we saw. This is a rainy season shot, so it's going to look a bit different. These are junipers. These are some of the blocks of olives. This is when you're talking about 400, 450 millimeters of rain on skeletal soils. That is tear jerking. It's a fantastic, for us, that was just fantastic. So we went over there. You can see what happened in rocks on hills, tops that weren't planted. This is one that was. This is what it looked like from a distance in the dry season. There's our little researchy area. There's the tree nursery down there. And there's an adjacent hilltop that wasn't planted. So the local people really saw the difference. This is what it looked like inside. So not just in the rainy season, not just a reasonably tall olive. I mean, that's sort of there. It's 21 years for an olive, but you know, 400 millimeters. Survival was fantastic. We were really pleased. And this soil is ghastly. It's just got almost nothing in it. But also the insects crawling around, birds twittering, stuff happening on the ground. You know, sadly, local people were going up and going to anything that crawled on the floor because of snakes. But lots of ground level biodiversity and little brown areas suggesting stuff. And I just saw a nest and put the thing and took a photograph and there's two eggs in it. I thought, whoa, really, really exciting. So we were terrifically excited. We got our measuring sticks out and we saw that juniper and eucalyptus, which would be this one here, there wasn't really a lot of interference between them. We looked at olives growing up in the middle of eucalyptus. It didn't seem to affect them. In other words, just by what my statistics professor used to call intraocular impact assessment, eyeballing it, it was, because you can't say eyeballing it in statistics, can you? It's not a technical word, but intraocular impact assessment is suitably impressive. So olives on their own were no different than olives underneath eucalyptus or olives underneath junipers. It's essentially the numbers that we've done since. This is a second site. You can see the great big eucalyptus on the side. They do grow fast compared to the olives and the junipers, it must be said. But here's some junipers, and we'll see the size of those a little bit later. And inside there, people pulling off two, sometimes three harvests of eucalyptus. They loved it because they could grow native forest alongside a harvestable resource. So this was the real discovery. Junipers and olives growing inside the eucalyptus, that's what it looks like inside, and you can see underneath indigenous forest coming up. This gentleman took it upon, hits his land. There's been a land use change since then. Every single farmer can take responsibility for their trees and their land. It's not government anymore. So people took different decisions. Some cut olives, not many, some did, because it grows too slow and they wanted eucalyptus. This guy said, I like the olives, not just for me, but for my children. I want these trees to be up there because I can see what's happening. So he started looking after them. Sadly, and for some strange reason that we don't know, when it became clear that we were really fascinated by this guy's decision, the next day he went back and three of his olives had been broken off. You know, in the way that vandalism sometimes happens, and you sort of think, okay. So we took, you just note little things like that, but by and large, to come to a number at the end, you know, over 90% survival after 20 years without fences across, this is just fantastic. So anyway, he's still growing these on and he's spending time fussing with them. Very little disease. There was some, but you know, they didn't seem to mind. It slowed growth down. We didn't find a lot of pathology in this thing. We didn't find any fire, didn't find any insects, didn't find any people doing bad things, except for toothbrushes. The two biggest difficulties we're facing are grazing and people walking past the trees, snapping them, because they make great toothbrushes. Strip off a little bit of the bark and not, they make little toothbrushes, which are fabulous. As does Dodonaea viscosa, another tree which is not at all threatened, so we're encouraging people to move to that. This is the same guy and the same junipers that we saw. He's kind of gone a little bit enthusiastic with the pruning, but you get the point. He's super interested in this. This was done on by himself. He just wanted the poles, the timber. So he's left the top knot on there, and fantastic. He's just working out his own little bit of silviculture there, and the trees, every single juniper, every single olive on his land has survived. 100% survival after 21 years. And he's looking after them very well. At the bottom of a slope in a third village, we got some fantastic results, 21, 22 foot, you know, a foot a year more with overland flow feeding that. So we measured those up. Equally, we had some disappointing results because people had put their animals through in this third village, not in the first two. Even today, they don't put their animals through because the boys and girls that weren't even born then, that you go up and say, why don't you bring your animals over here? They say, because there's olive trees over there. And then we say, so? And our parents tell us we mustn't put our animals through the olive tree. So you keep them over here, away from them? Oh, yeah. But they've done it for 20 years in two villages, not even grazed any animals. In this site, they haven't done that. And you can see, this is a 21-year-old olive. You can see how animal grazing does that. If you took the animals away, this would find its terminal bud and just go straight up. Olive's very resilient. Some wonderful research done in other parts, Iran, actually, about how olives, and Greece, how olives can survive a lot of grazing. We also had another experiment. We planted about 150 trees in a tree nursery that were watered regularly and never had any input at all. There's a person there, and that's the olive tree. So they can really do quite well. And those data are in the paper here. That's another site to illustrate one hill that was a control site compared to a hill that wasn't. This was a pretty rocky, despairing hill that nobody was using. That we decided to go for. And you can see here three different land uses in the experiment. First of all, in the micro watershed at the head, in a rainy season, they've planted, because the overland flow, the water feeds this, the terraces have been maintained. You can see that people have put a bit of effort into looking after this and planting wheat and barley. This was left deliberately as a control, no terrace repair, animals allowed to graze freely. And that's kind of how that stayed. And over here is our experimental area with grasses, some eucalyptus stands. These are junipers, actually. So that kind of just shows the difference on a much harsher site after 20 years. That there it is again in a bit of perspective. After that, we had a chat with the elders in the village. This gentleman came along and we never met before. He's the priest. We'd never met before. He walked up onto the hillside and blessed me and asked me what I was doing. And we had a bit of a chat. He said, yeah, I heard about you. Because one of these sites is called Scott Site in the local language, which is really flattering, really interesting, because it didn't have a name for the little tiny hill before, so they just called it Scott Site. And these guys are really keen to go on. They said, what we want to do is have a group discussion. Would you be willing to come? And the priest said, whether he's willing or not, he's coming to come to this meeting the next day. So the government arranged a vehicle for me to go back. They took me to a site where there'd been a little bit of damage. People had historically broken off some junipers, but not many. I counted 15 trees in this experiment that had been deliberately damaged. People just taking wood because they needed a bit. And a little bit here about harvesting. You can see that the eucalyptus coppicing quite well. Other side benefits. A bee eater suddenly appeared. We didn't know if that's the nest. I did ask, but this is rather nice to see quite a variety of bird life coming back. We'll return to birds shortly because they are absolutely critical, as it turns out, in decision making about conservation. I'll say why. Shortly, people spontaneously reserving their nurseries for olive germination because we developed a single technique for growing olives. So this was not government telling them to do this. They wanted them, so they're just growing them and actually making a little bit of profit off the olives because they're selling them back to the government at a few cents each. And people that I met when they were much younger and when I was much younger all sort of coming down and saying hi. This woman was 9 when I was out there, and she's now deputy nursery manager. The ministry folks came out with their clipboards and started doing the measuring things, so I said, let's stay in the village and train up some local people in how to use theodolites and how to measure root shoot ratio, well, not root shoot ratios, but canopy area, leaf area indexes, things like this, putting into local language, trying to get some measurement going, and eventually she was consistently overruled by the two guys who were the government people very nicely, but they quickly took the notebook from her and quickly took the compass from her, and because she didn't know what to do, so I took them away. Thankfully, local language really helps being able to speak, and we worked up how to use this. That's the nursery manager, the new nursery manager there. And we worked out, and it only took like 3 minutes, 4 minutes. How do you use a measuring tape? How do you enter those data into a book? It takes moments. And so now the entire book is written in her hand, and that book has been photographed and is in their village in her hand, so that she can then, and two other women, they said, what are you doing? And she got the notebook out and showed them in her handwriting what she'd been doing. Much, much better for long-term sustainability. We geo-referenced every single tree, because this is going to be significant, hopefully, 20 years from now. But we all learned how to use the theodolite. We all learned how to use the measuring apparatus. And so forth. We just took an extra day to make sure that was done. This is an interesting one for me, because this is right by the road where people go backwards and forwards and backwards and forwards all day and all night, and they still hadn't cut the trees. Nothing coming at night as well. That's the road there to the right. And Samson, good friend, sort of just measuring. We were in the middle of the woods, so trying to let him see us, because it was quite challenging just measuring all the trees. But this is big for the local people to be able to walk past that and compare it with that. They get sort of an impact every day. Here's the priest and the so-called guard, who needs a bit more money to. They don't need much. They need £150 a year to guard this whole site. That's it. That's a couple of hundred bucks a year to look after that, and they do a great job. This is the party that we had that was sprung on me unbeknownst, and the people that did the work. These are the guys that did the work, and they were so pleased to see me back 20 years later. And we all talked about how old we looked, but how strong we all still were, and how many more years were left in us to do even more fantastic things. It was great. And this man walked 3 kilometres to come and see me, and he walked and he kissed my hand and we sat down, and I said, I'm really sorry, I can't remember, Kasai was his name. And he stood up in the after we'd finished eating, and he said, I'd like to stand up and make an apology. And everybody was going, what do you want to say sorry for? He said, because I spent a lot of time telling you all, as you will remember, that we shouldn't be doing this. And I tried to slow this down, and I think that's why it took so long to get going, because I and others like me were very resistant of this project. And now that we see the results, we want to extend it. So I'd like to apologize to you now for slowing your work down, and I'd like to just hold your hand. So it was really a lovely moment to meet Kasai, because a lot of people have passed on that were working. But anyway, so they now have gone to the government themselves and asked, could we extend this across the 15 villages on the plateau? And as for this young one on the left-hand side, who ambled up behind my Land Rover one day with this cute little animal, there she is, with her two kids. What, don't I know you? She said, walking along the ridge top with her two little kids. And this is the thing where the birds come in, and which is really, of all the stuff I've talked about, really the most encouraging for me. What wall wasn't there when I was there, and I spoke to Asmaram, the Sheikha Asmaram, the nursery manager, and said, what's the worst site close to here? And he said, there, this is just a latrine and a place where we move our goats, that's it. So I said, what about we try planting trees in rock? So he said, well, you're mad. But we took pickaxes and crowbars, and we prized open some of this regolith, and we made about that much dirt with animal manure, well, donkey manure and clay and a bit of organic matter, and that was their bed. So once we prized it apart, we kind of put that in there and carefully, before the sun came up, put these seedlings in. There were 112 of them, I think, in this area. A mixture, something like that, a mixture of local species. Not so many eucalyptus, but one or two, because there were eucalyptus either side of it. And let them go. And they stuck in, they hung on, and they didn't grow, and they didn't grow, and they didn't grow, but they slowly did. And they could be watched, because it's right by the nursery. Now they say that nothing is allowed to happen there. They're not allowed. If you want a bit of peace, you can walk in there, because the sound of the birds in there is terrific. The birds only see a little bit, and then they have to fly a long way to see another little bit, like a cemetery or something. But this place is teeming with birds. It's lovely, and it sounds great, and the wind coming through the tree. And they describe all this quite poetically in the local language, and say, this is our little biodiversity conservation area. So on that basis, we figured that this was the first sort of local biosphere reserve in this part of Eritrea. There are no others, but spontaneously they've said they protected it. They chose to build a wall around it to say this has got to be protected, and asked why. They say because it sounds nice. We can hear the birds, we can hear the wind, it smells nice and it's cool. So if we want a bit of peace, this is where we go. And nobody pees there or anything. It's just kept special. And they've called it a holy site in their own language. They just call it a special site and a holy site. Not in any religious way, but just in a spiritual kind of a way. It's quite nice. That's what it looks like coming in from the road. These were the pre-existing junipers, and this little area is their special little area. So key findings then. We found that there have been significant increases in productivity in this area where extreme erosion, harsh climate were thought by local people and by government people to limit possibilities for livelihoods improvement and for grazing and forestry. We found that soils can be protected and the watersheds and livelihoods at lower elevations can be protected through creative ecological restoration at higher levels. So in my mind, I think that now these high elevation areas in East Africa are every bit as important for livelihoods at lower slopes as our coral reefs, as our estuaries, as our rainforests. No soil or water or shelter at the top, no coffee below, nothing at the top, no elephants below, nothing at the top, no agriculture. You know, it's gone, and Eritrea will say that its major export is soil to the Sudan. So these upper elevations become critical to me for the first time. You know, you read about this stuff, don't you, in your life, that actually watershed protection and things, this really brought it home to me and said, yes, you, at a micro watershed level, expanding up, taking a watershed approach, you can start to really do something useful on soils that I didn't, well, rock that I didn't think you'd be able to work with. Obviously, this has climate change implications. These places are very much dependent on orographic cloud, which does decline when the vegetation is stripped away. There's no orographic cloud now at all in the north of Eritrea we're speaking of, and around these areas. Trees just make their own little microclimate. So. And the fact that it was strong support was helpful. A few numbers, we had fantastic germination rates. I was struggling with how to germinate, and we were hitting seeds with hammers and doing all sorts of things. And Poicephalus parrots came in and sat in that little nursery earlier and picked up the seeds and got the seed out with their tongue, but they dropped a few. So then I went back to the States, I came with little hand vices, you know these little G-clamps that you can get, the hand vices, worked out how to, I smashed many, many olive seeds, but then we went back to work with the Tigray women on these, and that every single seed was opened with a G-clamp. So we exported 150 G-clamps to all the nurseries and trained up all these people, and it was fun. So parrots, thank you parrots for showing us how to do this. Lots of survival, good growth rates, and the fact that there's an economic gain with the eucalyptus, with the interplanting, this experimental design really. And they could be left with juniper olive. The options are to take out, to grub out the eucalyptus and just have native forest restored, or to keep this going. There's lots of different management options going through time that local people can decide themselves because they have control over that. So that's quite pleasing. Obviously, the commitment of local people was particularly important. And where we're going to now, we presented this in Norway. Thank you again, Norway. Full acknowledgement to Drylands Coordination Group and Norwegian Development Agency and to Svein Olsen and others for getting into Norway for an international conference that I ran about a year and a half ago. Folks from Ethiopia, Kenya, Tanzania, Malawi on talking about their concerns. Now, down further south, some of their concerns are political intrigue, where politicians will say, you know, vote for me and you can have this much land. The Uluguru Mountains in Tanzania, the other mountains in East Africa are losing their trees for slightly different reasons, but it's well known why. So we are now, the next step is to have an African conference, probably in Tanzania, hopefully later this year, if not next year, to get everybody sharing their results properly and maybe to try to raise the profile of African mountain woodlands. Get David Attenborough involved if you can, and see where we take it from there. So that's the big thing if and where we're going here. There's a network now of these people. Thank you very much. I think we have some time for questions if you would like, or comments, or yeah. What?
Yeah, after 20 years, do you see any natural regeneration with junipers or the olives?
Not with the junipers, just starting with the olives, because they just started coming into seed, but we didn't see anything from the ground, only the fruiting. We only saw them fruiting, but no natural regeneration yet.
And when you planted the juniper, did you do anything other than prepping the soil? Why I'm asking is we had a very similar project probably about 15 years ago in the Bali Mountains.
Right.
And we couldn't get our junipers to grow. And we could get them to live, but they would be stunted. We'd come back 3 years and they would still be about that high. Hmm. And then later the local people told us you had to take soil from established junipers and mix it with water and get the microbial diversity. And then take that mud, that watery mud, and pour it on the new saplings to establish a microbial colony.
Yeah.
New ones. And we went to a couple other four or three places, and their 2 and 3 year old junipers were about this big.
Yeah.
So obviously it worked quite well.
Right.
I'm wondering if you had to do anything like that in this rocky soil.
Looked into it very carefully and did try one experiment with inoculum from a cemetery which had some really nice we presume mycorrhizal stuff going on, but olives are endomycorrhizal, juniper is ectomycorrhizal, so we would have thought that would have made a difference. It didn't make any difference, and actually the junipers did fine without any inoculation of soils from established cemeteries where there was that much organic matter. But we tried that, didn't seem to make a difference. They were stunted at the top, but you saw 20 years that they're a bit tall, well, a fair bit taller than this room now. Yeah.
You said that the man who had originally was sort of like poo-pooing the idea, was like, we want to extend this.
Yeah.
Have you heard anything more about what's currently being done, or has there been more?
No. No, not yet in that area. Communications are very difficult. Eritrea is not an easy place to get communications from or to maintain, actually. But we hope to get some grants going. We hope to get some cross-border work going. There's quite a lot of political and local work to do to make sure that those things can happen. But basically, we need a small grant and a little bit of commitment.
A seed grant?
if we could secure $10,000, whatever other expenses there are, but $10,000 that could be spent locally, we'd be up and running. It's a very small amount of money, but it would need a couple of airfares and a few things. So probably 25, 30 grand probably would set this off. No, heard nothing yet. Yeah.
At the beginning, you kind of introduced the several hypothesized drivers of what had led to the sort of deforested landscape. What was different? Do you have a sense of what those drivers, what the strong drivers were, and what changed to allow this to work? I mean, was it the grazing primarily being excluded in a lot of ways, or what changed the system dynamics, I guess?
Right. Two key changes. We have to put slightly to one side that some people allow grazing, and toothbrushes was the critical problem with olives. Okay, so people recognized very quickly that there was a gain with the eucalyptus, and they could see that things were surviving. For the first 2 or 3 years, there was a lot of support from local people. So I think there was a demand that was expressed in different ways. That's different, which wasn't expressed in the first area that I showed you. Secondly, the removal of animals grazing has clearly got to be one of the most important things. There are no Italians running around the place chopping trees down anymore, is another thing. But I think the two big ones would be local people wanting it and understanding the system, because in the first area, which I said was going to be lost, local people now are very much engaged through water rather than trees, because the government's come in with micro dams and check dams, help them build terraces. And the guy who was standing with the Kalashnikov by the soil pedestal, I don't know if you remember him, he's now in his 50s, and he said, we have to hang on to our trees. And he's running all over the plateau saying, we've got to do this. And he's been given the government award for that. So people's interest, remove the grazing, and actually drought is less significant. Once the trees are growing big, that they'll hang in there, for the most part. You've got to keep that grazing pressure and cutting pressure off. Yeah.
I think this is really phenomenal to see. I think one of the key things that kind of touched on, but I'm curious to hear like three key things in terms of how you engage the community to get their buy-in. It seems like you put a lot of work up front, learning the language, working with the different folks and training them on how to do all this stuff. Because it seems like all too often people quickly want to get in there and get inertia going and just kind of do it the way that they think they should do it. But it seems like you put in a lot of time and effort to really get the buy-in of the community and get them at a point where they can sustain this on their own, even though you did just go off and leave. And oftentimes once the person who spearheads it leaves, it kind of just peters out. But you've really seen a lot of success. And what are some of the takeaways that you saw in terms of what you did ahead of time to get this thing to be so successful?
Respect and understanding that that value drives a lot of your behavior in going to weddings and funerals and being with people so that you can kind of understand that bit of the society. Gender, making sure that it's not just one group that's involved. It's a 20-year project. The children that you're playing football with now will remember that you know, the conversations you have informally about olives and sitting down on rocks with key children's leaders, boys and girls at the age of 12, who are leaders, talking with them about what's going to be happening to this little thing 10, 15, 20 years from now, going into the school, taking classes with the school. So anything that comes off of that, how you translate the notion of respect into that learning that you've got to do. But then I think the second thing is the transition to let go. No matter how much you want it, my babies, you're gone. And it's got to be them. It has to be the local ownership. There's no shortcut to that, because when you're gone, you're gone. And the trees can go overnight. They can just be gone. So the process of letting go is a negotiated process. What happens when? What will be the consequences of? If this, then what? Negotiating the let go and who's got it, making sure that they know who's got it and that the others know who's got it locally. Those would be the two big ones, I think, for me. I have to say, though, that the sum of the biology was really critical. I now am really, really pleased that we did convince the Norwegians and everybody else to put a lot of time into nursery silviculture and into digging decent holes. You know, this half moon terrace that you can do, you dig a half moon, it's that big, and it's got one seedling in it. That's expensive up front. We did 700 or 800 of those on very difficult land. It's very, very hard work. So I think that paid off as well. The everything to do with the front end paid off quite a lot. Mostly it's the social side. 99% of my PhD was gone. All the biology of my PhD went out the window. Mostly it was learning how to drink coffee. Yeah.
I was just wondering what was the original start of, or the impetus to do this project in for your PhD, or you know, how did you get started in Eritrea in the first place? Like, was that something you had been there before, or was it just that this project that you advised for that?
Well, on the personal side, because this links with the institutions that the Eritreans had and other countries have, but in my case it was the Eritreans, because there's a lot of self-reliance, a lot of encouragement from the Eritreans. The Eritreans gave me a huge amount of support and a care during their independence war. So without that institutional support of the Liberation Front, there would have been nothing. But from my side, I went out as a nurse during the famine to work as a volunteer nurse in refugee camps. And when you see a refugee camp in Africa and thousands of people that don't normally come to a particular place, you see the ecology gone. So I worked as a nurse with traditional healers, traditional birth attendants. I had a bit of an entry point that a lot of men wouldn't perhaps have to some of the women's views on this. They still wouldn't share their secrets with me, but we would talk in general about which plants and what they did and stuff. So they were distressed because they couldn't do any of their healing because the plants were gone as soon as people were moved by war or drought. And that got me much more interested in my schoolboy kind of interest, which was biology, and I was allowed to go back and do a bachelor's thesis living with them. And then it was anger. It's just like, this is just the, as soon as I said to myself and realized I am actually staying in the most northerly remnant of African mountain woodland in Africa, this is it. When it's gone, it's gone. And it goes all the way right down to the Orange River, and this is the last bit. And the Eritreans were totally on board. You know, we've got to protect this. And then it was getting Svein Olsen on board. So channeling that emotion, I think. Sir?
Help me to understand the scale. In your pictures that show a wonderful tree that survived a grove of trees in 20 years, you could also see in the background mass destruction, no, with no trees. What's it like scale-wise? Is this just tiny little islands?
Yes. It's tiny little islands. It's about, each one would be about 10 times the size of the church that you saw in that sea of agriculture. So now it really is about scaling up. And that's why I'm slightly encouraged, because we can scale up if we can work with other groups. But we need to, that's the critical question now. And we discussed at the conference how to do that. And that involves some restoration, some protection. In some places, fences. It involves a lot of political will. It involves some small grants. It involves exchanges of villages between African countries or within African countries to see this. But yeah, scaling up, big thing. They're small. Good. Thank you very much for that question. Yeah.
Thanks. I'm interested in traditional practices around restoration. So you mentioned now famous, more and more work being done in Ethiopian based churches, particularly, and their conservation of these islands, of forest and seeds of agriculture. Do you see any other examples of that? I mean, are there other, locally based or traditionally based, restoration efforts going on in these areas?
There are. Mostly it has to do with the understanding that everything's stripped off by animals, so managing grazing, either through little bits of cut and carry or steering animals through, working with the young people to steer their animals through other areas and making sure that some areas are designated, protected in some way, either through giving them a special language or something like that. That would be most of it, so giving the trees a chance. And then secondly, where they have been exposed to some things, getting seedlings to local people because they're precious, and working in the house. So you get two or three olives in your courtyard, or a eucalyptus for them, junipers too. So getting local trees grown there. And schools. Schools are very quick to get on board with some of this stuff if they can. Yeah. That's about the extent of it to my knowledge, but perhaps there's others. I don't know if anybody else has come across things, but in my place that would be about it. Yeah.
You said earlier in the talk that it's absolutely essential that there were no fences.
Yeah.
Fences, that would help keeping livestock out from being grazed. But what was the main reason why there couldn't be fences?
Several reasons. Fences don't last. They're just an invitation to get broken. They're saying don't come here, so that's like saying don't do that. What do you do? Secondly, they're very expensive and they take a lot of effort. Thirdly, it's saying this isn't yours, this is something else, this is a bit special, or this is off limits. So the unspoken communications are pretty negative messages. But most importantly, if you want the experiment to succeed, then you need to understand what it means to move goats in a different area and establish what that means, and after a couple of seasons that people would get used to that. So they would have to negotiate their own understanding of what this special area meant and keep it there. And initially the fence was paint, so don't go over the painted area, and as the paint fell off the rocks, then, yeah. So those are some of the reasons.
My question is about the land tenure system in Eritrea.
Yeah.
You mentioned people individually own land.
Yeah.
And do you see that as a motivation for how this was a much more ground-up kind of approach, because people felt more responsible, they were more committed to the efforts of restoration?
Yeah.
And how do you see the effects of land ownership or land tenure when you think about scaling up this project potentially different contexts like Ethiopia?
Fantastic. Critical point. And it's not just about land, it's about trees, and it's not just about one type of ownership, it's about user rights, access rights, ownership rights through time and across space. So initially there was a coincidence of local elders in the village and the entire village actually agreeing that this land with little white paint around it was to be not used for 20 years. And that broke down minimally in one village, but it did break down a little bit because people grazed their animals through it, which they preferentially took the olives. When some years later, people were told that independent of the of whether this was Dehesa, which was communal land that's rotated every few years, Domeniale, which is common held land, or Risti, which is held as private property, independent of those land tenure arrangements, which is to do with the soil and dirt and stuff, the things that were growing on the land were transferred to local ownership. They all essentially became private, because those three land tenure systems, nevertheless, in the feudal system way back, people still know what's theirs and which family has which bit. And so stuff growing on there belongs to, and they were told the government will not do anything if you choose to chop down this olive tree or anything like that. So there's something there that I can start to get a handle on, but not describe completely, because I haven't done the work necessary. And I'm not sure that the government got it complete. I'm not quite sure that that has been fully understood by everybody. There's something there about the differences between what the ownership of the land and the ownership, access, and use of stuff that grows on the land. And I think a little bit more work needs to be done to understand, to get precisely at your question, which is a very good question, very important, fundamental question, actually, to successes of experiments like this, work like this. Yeah?
You said that one of the men traveled, I think, 3 kilometers to come and see you, and that's fabulous. And so I wonder, you know, you have this type of restoration success, if any of those leaders could take this knowledge and transfer it, maybe, you know, even if it's just, do you see this potential for them to train, you know, kind of you train them and now they go and establish this in other villages and help other villages to realize this?
Absolutely. If the potential was there, and the Eritrean government would love to do that as well. The Eritreans would love to be supporting their people to do this kind of stuff. It's cash strapped and it's difficult to do so. But yes.
So you do think it would be supported by
the... I think the Eritrean government would fully support this and would love to see their people moving this around and getting other stuff going. Yeah, definitely. The ministry is very much behind this. They've been fantastic colleagues, fantastic advisors, and been really supportive. I know you hear bad stuff, but there's good stuff too, and there's a lot of good stuff going on, and that would be one of it. That would be part of it, that the ministry is doing very, very good things. Mm.
Thanks, Scott, one more time.
And once again, thanks to the Norwegians, and thanks especially to the Eritreans, the Eritrean villagers, and the Eritrean government for supporting this.